Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Monroe Live. I'm Tom Prochet. I'm your host of the Monroe Live podcast today. If you don't know who Monroe is, we're a lean design, lean manufacturing consultancy. We're famous for EV product costing and benchmarking, along with this very Monroe Live social media channel. So I'm director of electrification for Monroe, so I get involved with all things high voltage related here at Monroe, and today that is no exception. Today we're going to be talking about Beam Global, a new emerging charging infrastructure company that's got lots of promise and capability that's already existing. So this is a solar charger, if you will, capable of producing 100% renewable power, which is a wonderful thing. They've got a pretty big customer base. We'll be talking about that. They have a flagship product that they call EV Arc. We'll talk a little bit about that. Today, our interview is with Beam Global CEO, Mr. Desmond Wheatley. Desmond will provide us his unique perspectives on what he's seeing in the larger EV market in terms of demand, areas of opportunity, what happens next, etc., and of course, the importance of the charging infrastructure being off-grid in their case, and what steps are necessary to see growth in EVs. And with that, you know, I introduce Desmond. Please, Desmond, give us a little intro, who you are, your little bit of your personal background maybe, and your history with Beam, and maybe a little Beam's history too, if you will.
Good. Well, Tom, thank you for the introduction, and thanks very much for having me here. Thanks to everybody listening. I'll spend the least amount of time on me because I'm the least interesting part of the story. But suffice it to say that I've had a very varied professional career. I've been involved in energy now for last couple of decades, one way or another. But mostly, I spent a lot of time in the Middle East, and then prior to Beam Global. And then before that, I was in telecommunications, the maritime sector. So very broad selection of professional experiences. One of the things that's been central to all of them has been the financial aspect of it. So I've also raised a great deal of capital in my history. I mean, a lot for me anyway. But in every instance where I raised the money, I wasn't doing that for the mercenary aspects of it. I was doing it to fund various activities, which I then remained operationally involved in moving forward. That gives you quite a different discipline than when you're simply getting paid for the transaction. You actually have to operate the entity post-raise. So I've been with Beam Global now since the first quarter of 2010. It was formerly called Envision Solar, and it was actually founded to do something very different than what we do nowadays. At that time, it was actually a sort of architectural services firm, oddly enough, but they were concentrating on providing bespoke solar shading structures for a parking lot environment. So it was tangentially similar to what we were doing. And at the time, it was a very novel idea, frankly. Nobody was doing that. But as you will all know, since that time, that's become a highly commoditized business and driven by normalized cost per kilowatt hour, not by architectural considerations. So we very quickly transitioned out of that as soon as I got involved with the company and moved away from sort of project-based revenues to product-based revenues. That seemed like the better way to grow at the time, particularly because I was very keen on the electrification of transportation. Tom, one of my many failings is that I'm often too early to the party where technology is concerned, but I'm happy to report that I'm less often wrong about what will happen. And I'm fortunate in that I have a great deal of energy to stick to things that I care about and want to push forward. So back in 2010, we started that transition towards products. We invented and took through the patenting process, particularly the EV Arc product, which is the flagship that you talked about. And frankly, had a very tough few years because there weren't a lot of electric vehicles on the road, and we were making solar-powered electric vehicle charging stations. It really wasn't until the last 3 or 4 years that the product started to gain broad acceptance, and then we've seen absolutely earth-shattering growth since that time, 300% year-over-year growth last year, 200% the year before, and so on. Because there is a lot of growth in electric vehicles, but also a recognition that we need other options to provide the charging infrastructure moving forward.
Well, that's a good point you raise about maybe being too early sometimes is worse than being too late. But in this case here, you had the fortitude to stay with it, and now it's paying back some dividends, being such an early visionary of this sort of product line. Now it gets really deep. So let's dive a little bit into what the EV ARC does. You have on your website that you call it the EV ARC 2020. I assume that's kind of the year it was conceived or deployed. But I've got all sorts of attributes. I'd love to hear your twist on that. I mean, it's, you know, I hate to say it, but the charging infrastructure can be a cure for your insomnia. And you are doing something much, much different than what everybody else seems to be doing. And, you know, I'd love to hear the details of how it's different, and especially with the focus on the EV ARC and how it's working out for you.
Yes, I mean, I think you're absolutely right. Discussions about charging infrastructure can be, and I like your term, a cure for insomnia. And it shouldn't be, because actually it's one of the most exciting things that has happened, certainly from an infrastructure point of view, and that is happening for 100 plus years. And it also should be very, very exciting to the consumer, because it's going to change radically the way they fuel their vehicles, the economics around fueling their vehicles, and frankly, just the joy of driving. You're able to get some of it back, moving away from this sort of entrenched model that we have right now. So EV charging infrastructure ought to be exciting, but at the same time, it ought to happen without a great deal of theatrics. And that's, you know, that's the problem. Here we've got something that's on the surface kind of boring from a consumer point of view, but is in fact very dramatic in terms of what it takes to get it done. I would say that one of the greatest aspects of the EV ARC product and a couple of the other products that we have in our portfolio is that they remove the drama from the deployment of electric vehicle charging infrastructure. And chiefly, the way EV ARC does that is in that it provides EV charging infrastructure solutions, but without all of the things that you would typically associate with that. So we're able to deploy an electric vehicle charger, or up to six electric vehicle chargers, on a single EV ARC with no construction, no electrical work. So no construction means no trenching, no pouring concrete, no foundations, none of those things. No electrical work means no pulling wires, conduit, no transformer switchgear upgrades, none of those. And all of that means no permitting, because we don't trigger any of the normal permitting requirements, because we're not digging up the streets and we're not doing electrical work. There's no special inspections required or anything else like that. And then beyond that, it means that you don't get a utility bill, because the unit generates and importantly stores all of its own electricity. And we can come back to that in a minute. And then you're immune to blackouts and brownouts as well. One of the under-discussed things where electrification of transportation is concerned is what will we do when we need fuel, but we're having a prolonged blackout or brownout, which frankly happened more often than we like, and in fact more frequently today than at any time in our history, as we're moving into this period where we're more reliant on electricity. So EV ARC's really a drama reducer, but I hope it adds excitement. So in a way, we're sort of upending that, right? It's no longer boring infrastructure with a lot of drama to get it deployed. Now it's sort of exciting infrastructure with no drama to get it deployed.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. You know, the whole idea of being able to set up out in the wilderness without the need for any sort of grid infrastructure is a wonderful way forward by itself. It's one of the worst use cases for the EV is if you're traveling in the wilderness. So you've got a way to solve that for those with the wherewithal, and, you know, companies who may want to do this in remote areas could probably reap big benefits as the EV activity scales up in the United States. So I noticed a couple of other specs.
If I could just jump in there for a second.
Sure.
What's really fascinating about this, actually, is that the great majority of EV ARC deployments are not in remote locations. They're in heavily urbanized environments. I mean, New York City is our largest municipal customer. The U.S. Army is our largest customer, but New York City is our largest municipal customer. And we are deployed thickly through the five boroughs. And so then you say to yourself, well, hang on a minute. Why do you need an off-grid solution in the middle of the largest MTA in the nation? You know, what's going on here? And it turns out that actually it is often more complicated to deliver an electric circuit across a street or outside of a building in a place like New York City More permitting, more environmental impact studies, construction costs much higher, disruption much more impactful. And then, frankly, the biggest issue is lack of capacity. There simply isn't capacity to add the circuits that are required to do this. And so while our product on the face of it seems like a very obvious solution for remote deployments, and yes, we are in national parks. We're in all sorts of places where it would cost millions of dollars to dig the trenches and deliver the grids. But actually, the vast majority of the units that we have deployed, hundreds and hundreds of them across the United States, are in densely urban areas because it's just so expensive, so disruptive, and often impossible to deliver the grid to the place where people park cars in those types of environments. We solve that.
Very nice. And, you know, I notice also that it's quite a large solar array. I don't know if the specs have evolved, but 4.4 kilowatts of solar power, that's nothing to sneeze at. Being able to withstand 160-mile-an-hour winds, okay, that gives you some flexibility in where you deploy it. Wide operating temperature range, operating at colder temperatures than most EVs will charge at. So that's always nice. Same with the upper temperature range. Different storage options, power output up to almost 6 kilowatts if the specs remain the same as they are on the website, that is. So what can you say about those things? I mean, this is sort of unique. Can the solar array be larger? Can you accommodate other types? I know you're trying to focus on a product here, and everyone's going to want that product to be something different. So what sort of variants do you support, if any?
Yeah, it's a really interesting point, actually. In the early days when we were doing this, we got a lot of requests to, alter the product. Can you make it this? Can you make it a bit more of that and a bit less of this and all that sort of stuff? And you're right, we had to discipline ourselves. And one of the great challenges has been coming up with a product which we can deploy in any... One of the many fantastic things about these United States of America is that you have every conceivable condition here. If you can deploy broadly across the U.S., you can deploy anywhere in the world, frankly, because you have the conditions in this country which match just about everything. Perhaps the tip of the Arctic or Antarctica we can't match, but everything else, we've got the hottest deserts. We've got places where hurricanes and tremendous humidity run through. We've got incredibly low temperatures up in the Midwest in the winter. You know, we have an operation in Chicago, and I go there a lot. And, I know what it's like to have my extremities feel painful as I walk down the street, to the office, partly because I'm a fool that never takes a coat when I go there, or gloves. But nevertheless, we have these tremendously extreme environments across the United States. And we had to develop a product which could be deployed in all of those environments and provide what our customers needed in all of those deployments. And one of the things you mentioned was operating temperature. Certainly, that was probably the biggest hurdle we had to cross, actually. Batteries and other electronics, but particularly batteries, a bit like Goldilocks. They don't like things too hot or too cold. And so the traditional way of keeping batteries in that Goldilocks zone is to heat them or to air condition them. But of course, we have a finite source of electricity. You mentioned that 4.4 kilowatt solar array. What we want to do is put all the energy that we convert from sunlight into electricity into the car. We don't want to use large amounts of it on parasitic loads like heating and air conditioning. And so coming up with passive thermal management solutions that did not require us to dip into our finite source of electricity that we want to put in cars was a very, very big hurdle to cross. And frankly, it was the hardest thing to solve on the whole product. You mentioned earlier that the product's called EV Arc 2020, and what that should be is an illustration of the fact that we are far better engineers than we are marketers, because actually it is true that in 2020 we made a major structural change to the product, and that was why we chose that name EV Arc 2020, because, and it also had the sort of provision of perfect eyesight and perfect vision and all that going along with it. However, here we are 4 years later, having done lots to improve the product in that time, and it particularly, by the way, as we've now branched out into Europe, we just expanded into Europe at the end of last year, and of course Europeans look at you like 2020, what does that mean? It has no other connotation to them, so I think you should expect to see a change there. But product's been constantly improving since that time. And we're able to get tremendous, very talented team of engineers on staff here, aerospace background, maritime engineering backgrounds, energy engineering backgrounds, all of the combination of those things, which keeps eking out more and more energy from the same footprint. To your point about can the array be bigger, what's really crucial about EV ARC is it fits inside a standard legal size parking space. And even more crucial, it doesn't reduce available parking in any way at all. This was another one of the big engineering challenges that we had. We wanted something that you could drop off in a parking space, not have to bolt it down, not have to glue it down, not have to dig foundations or do any on-site work at all. It had to be zero on-site work. But at the same time, we could not reduce the available parking on the property because most jurisdictions have some kind of minimal parking requirement for the use case on the property. And once you get that property permitted with, let's say, 100 parking spaces, if you drop a shipping container or a big lump of concrete or something in one of those spaces, you now go to 99 spaces. No developer ever deploys a space more than they need to because that's a cost center, not a revenue center. And so now you've just knocked the property out of compliance. One of the crucial things about EV ARC is because of the way it's engineered, we're able to drop it in a parking space, have it survive actually 185 mile an hour winds is what we've survived. We're rated for 160 mile an hour winds, but and stamped for that. Floodproof to 9.5 feet as well, by the way. But it's able to do all of those things, but without reducing available parking. So you don't lose a parking space, even though we've put something in your space. We just made that parking space much more useful than it used to be. Because after all, if you think about it, a parking space, once you park a car in it, is useless for anything else. We've sort of changed that dynamic.
Well, that makes sense that you would try to keep the array to that size for that purpose.
Yes.
But one of the ways you're able to get away with such a small array, if you will, considering the grand task, is solar tracking. So how does that work on your system?
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up. The tracking is absolutely essential. Now, just want to tell you, I mean, I have an engineering background myself, and I spent a great deal of time looking at finance and economics too. I can tell you that were I doing utility scale deployments out in the desert, or even most rooftop deployments, I would not introduce tracking. There's more cost. And there's opportunity for failure. Anything that moves increases opportunity for failure. However, in our instance, we are endeavoring to squeeze all the energy density that we can out of a finite piece of real estate, the size of a parking. Now, parking space in the United States, 9 feet by 18 feet. So you're trying to eke out all of the electrical energy that you can, because after all, the task of the EV ARC, aside from providing emergency power through the e-power panel, and that's another story and an important one. We have lots of first responders and others across the country who are able to use our product to provide that emergency power when they need it, uniquely in the space. No other EV charging company does that. But aside from doing that, putting power into cars is what's most important. So we will throw everything, including the kitchen sink, at engineering ways to squeeze out more generation and storage on the product so we can put more power or miles into electric vehicles. The tracking solution that we have, a patented tracking solution, allows us to reorient the solar array. But we do it in a way which is very clever, and this is what we have the patent on. It doesn't actually ever leave the lineal alignment of the parking lot, parking space rather. So we drop this thing in a parking space. The solar array is over the parking space, shading your car, which is another nice benefit. And there's some technical benefits come with that too. But and then as we reorient it during the course of the day, as the sun moves from the east in the morning through south at lunchtime across to the west at the end of the day, we reorient the solar panel in such a way that we never actually leave the lineal alignment of the parking space. It's really kind of a special and unique attribute that we have, and we have good patents on that. That reorientation of the solar panel gives us about 25%. More electricity than a fixed array. And by the way, this is not theoretical. We've tested it. It's very simple for us to do that. We just turn off the tracking facing south, see how we do, and then we compare that to when the tracking's turned on. About 25% more electricity. That 25% electricity means 25% more miles delivered into electric vehicles. Absolutely crucial. And a very important differentiator with the product. Even if somebody copied the EV ARC product in every way, but they didn't copy that because of our patent. We have lots of other patents in the makeup of the product, but if just that one patent, if that was the only barrier to entry, our product would put 25% more miles into electric vehicles than the competing product without the tracking. So it's very important.
Very cool. So, make a major change to the product in 2020. Here it's 4 years later. I won't try to drag you through what those changes were. But there's one recent change that you're probably trying to deal with, and that's NACS. Suddenly the charging standard is changing on you. So how's that working for you? Are you going to roll that one out too?
Well, so this is actually one of the really fundamentally crucial things to understand about Beam Global. And it's been very deliberate right from when I first took over. I'll take you back to 2010 now and the thought process around developing this company and developing the products. And there were some sort of major headline thoughts. First of all of electrification will all of transportation will electrify. I was convinced of that in 2010. I'm even more convinced of it today. The next point was, well, what does that mean? How will people charge their vehicles or fuel their vehicles in the future? And my feeling back then, and I feel it even more strongly today, is that fueling would become much more like connecting to Wi-Fi than the gas station model, right? We're all used to having Wi-Fi everywhere. It doesn't need to be terribly fast, but it needs to be fast enough for our use case. And we would no more go somewhere special and sit around and wait to connect to Wi-Fi today. Then I think we will do that to fuel our vehicles in the future. The 100-year-old model has been: you go to a gas station, you wait while you pump, you know, carcinogenic and volatile liquid into a steel box under your children's bottoms, and then you drive off. And it's an experience that is often described as convenient nowadays, by which people mean there are gas stations everywhere. But actually, I think it's an incredibly inconvenient experience. I haven't done that for years. My vehicle is always full because I'm always charging it where I was already going. I don't make special trips for charging. I do it where I was already going. I'm lucky enough to be able to charge at the office, and I'm also one of the few lucky people who can charge at home as well. That doesn't describe the broader population, but luckily for early adopters of EVs, that has been the case. But anyway, back 10 years ago, we started thinking about this. We said, okay, EV charging needs to be everywhere. And then we said, well, what does that mean? Well, that means we need to start putting electrical circuits everywhere, and particularly in places that they've never been before, places where people park cars. No one's ever run electricity to those environments. That starts to seem very complex. I had built a lot of stuff previously. I knew what it was like to get the phone call at 3 o'clock in the morning. We hit Caliche Rock. The trench isn't going to take 3 days. It's going to take 3 months. You know, it's going to cost millions of dollars instead of hundreds of thousands or whatever. I've had all those phone calls, and that really worried me. The siege mentality of building out this type of infrastructure really worried me. And so that led me to this idea of, we need to come up with a product which replaces the infrastructure that's required to make EV chargers work. But I don't want to get in the EV charger business. This is 10 years ago I'm thinking this. I don't want to get in the EV charger business because the EV charger is an appliance. And it's appliance with services behind it. And all of us know that appliances change rapidly. Things are, you know, we're now moving to USB-C on our iPhones, away from Lightning. Before that, we had large US. You know, all of this stuff shifting around, moving around rapidly. And that's great because that's innovation. But I don't want to get into that fight. I just don't know enough, and I don't feel prescient enough to do that. So what do all EV charging companies have in common? What do all of the appliances have in common? They all require a mounting asset and a source of electricity. Okay, let's make a product that supplies a mounting asset and a source of electricity. And now we really don't care what kind of plug they use. We don't care what services succeed and which ones fail. We don't care which companies succeed and fail. We really don't care about any of that stuff. And that's exactly what we did. We have come up with a suite of products which don't charge cars. Our products provide power and a mounting asset for the appliances and the service providers that charge cars. The result of that is you will see our products all over the United States with other people's chargers on them. ChargePoint, Blink, Electrify America, Enel, any quality brand, any quality service provider, you will see their products operating on our products, but without construction, without electric work, without a utility bill, and without risk from blackouts or brownouts. So the move from J1772 to 3600 or NECS to us, meaningless, absolutely meaningless. Don't have to do anything at all because we're still supplying the same mounting asset and the same power supply. And you might have noticed, I don't know if you had a chance to see this, Tom, but we just recently announced that we're now patented on our wireless EV ARC solution. I happen to believe that cars will, in the future, have the receivers for wireless charging because it's magnificent. I've used it. It's really cool. I think consumers will demand it. And we now have a patent on our ability to provide that wireless charging. But what you won't see us doing, at least not in the near future, is coming up with our own wireless charger. We will simply deploy any of the other fine companies like Hevo or others out there into our EV ARC in the same way that we've been putting the charge points, the Blinks and the Electrify Americas on our existing products. So, sorry, it was a long answer, but it is a very important aspect of our business that we're more about solving the infrastructure than the appliance problem.
And, you know, way to go. You know, you talked early on about avoiding the drama. You avoided a big, huge piece of drama with that effort. So
yes, indeed. Yes. Indeed. At a lot of cost.
Yes. So I did notice that with the power output at just under 6 kilowatts, that sounds like our J1772 level 2 sort of AC charging. Any thoughts about DC charging going forward?
Yes, we do that too.
You do. Okay.
So we do DC fast charging as well. With the EV ARC product, it requires a bank of four of them. So we interconnect above ground a bank of four EV ARCs, and then we connect a DC fast charger to that. It's all pre-engineered, so that, again, there's no construction or electrical work. And we've deployed those in rest areas in California. You can imagine how expensive it would be to upgrade electricity circuit to somewhere that is a remote location like that. But I will say this to you. I think DC fast charging is way oversold. And it's to do with this sort of lack of imagination that people have, all of us, myself included. I'm not separating myself from this. This is basically what you find is that people who don't drive electric vehicles think that DC fast charging is really, really important because they want to replicate the gas station experience. And this is, if you look back at all new technologies, whenever a new technology comes out, people try to make it look like the old technology because that's what people are comfortable with. And then pretty soon it migrates away from that. Cell phones used to have keypads on them. Now they have touch screens. You know, cell phones used to have curly wires in a suitcase. My first one did, you know, that you carry around, look just like a phone on a wall.
You had a Motorola bag phone like I did.
Yeah, exactly. What I will say is this. Most EV drivers, damn near all of them, actually, quickly move away from this idea that they should wait around and go somewhere and try to cram as much power as they can into their car at some place while they wait, like a gas station experience. They quickly move away from that whenever they have access to more ubiquitous but much slower charging. And I'll give you some numbers which are helpful here. And these are not my numbers. These are U.S. Department of Transportation numbers. I think we can rely on them. The average sedan in the United States drives 30.4 miles, just over 30 miles a day. The average human drives a little bit more. I guess that's because some of us are on buses or whatever. I don't know. But average sedan, 30.4 miles per day. 8 out of 10 commuters require 24 miles or less for their round trip. So not the average, 80% of them, 24 miles or less for their average. And fleet vehicles, and certainly more than half of our business is fleet in nature. That's army, that's, you know, cities and many corporate fleets as well. They're driving even less than that, typically, certainly under 30 miles a day, lots of them under 20 miles a day, and some of the larger fleets we deal with under 10 miles per day. As soon as you understand that, then you start to concentrate on what we've been concentrating on for 10 years, which is what we refer to as DRR, or daily range replenishment. Gone are the days of full, empty, full, empty, full, empty that we were trained into because none of us wanted to go to the gas station because far from being convenient, it was a horrible experience to do that. What in fact you do is you charge your car much more like you charge your cell phone, opportunistically whenever you can do it, and usually while you're doing something else. And so what this means is if you take that 30.4 miles per day that the average US sedan drives and plug it into one of our slower units, in an hour and a half or so, you've got your entire daily range replenishment. Your vehicle's always full. You didn't go somewhere special. And by the way, if there's anything that your car battery doesn't like, it's charging and discharging really quickly. And there's lots of magnificent technology trying to solve for that. But the simple fact of the matter is physics tells you that if you cram a lot of energy into that battery quickly, you're going to have a thermal event. And that's something that the battery, it would prefer not to have. If you just top your battery off all the time, you're going to have much less impact on the car. the battery, the infrastructure required to provide it, it's going to be much less expensive, and you're going to find that you really fall in love with the Life Electric. Because once you learn that you don't need to go somewhere special and hang around, I'll give you the one use case, of course, for DC fast charging makes a lot of sense is long, what I'll call corridor type driving. I'm in San Diego. If I want to go to San Francisco, all but the most nefarious characters don't want to spend hours hanging around in rest areas. And so we want to get them in and out of there quickly. And that's why we do DC fast charging in those types of environments. For everything else, which is the great majority of driving, DRR, daily range replenishment, serves you beautifully. And you cannot believe how efficient it is. You don't even think of it anymore. You just go where you're already going. You plug in, you leave the thing alone. My vehicle's fueling right now while I'm talking to you.
DC fast charging, I'm assuming then, you follow the same model as with AC. This is somebody else's DC fast charger, I would assume.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
At which point, yet another piece of drama avoided, so kudos. Good work. That kind of divorces you from the whole concern about, 800 volts versus 400 volts. If someone wanted to use an 800-volt DC fast charger, are you able to accommodate that?
Yeah, so the answer is there's nothing in science or technology that prevents us doing that. The market has not forced that upon us yet. And so we are responsive to market, right? Although having started out the call telling you that I was making solar powered electric vehicle charging stations in 2010 when there were only four electric cars on the road, and I don't mean models, I mean absolute four. So clearly I do things that are not always market driven, right? But at least with a view to it. But we try to be as responsive as the market, and especially as busy as we are at the moment, we are going to focus on those chargers which we see being most commonly used, and we're going to create infrastructure products to service them. But there's nothing in science or technology that prevents us moving up to the higher voltage. In fact, there are many things about it that we like.
So you've avoided the drama of NACS, the drama of DC fast charging, a subject of hot debate, all for the reasons you stated here. Once people are educated about it, they quite often shy away from it all on their own without being provoked away from it. So, yes, I love the idea of just simply replenishing the charge that you've used that day. So you've got more products than just the EV ARC. You've got this Beam All Cell and the ARC Mobility Trailer. What can you tell us about those things?
Yeah, so let's start with our battery technology, the All Cell technology. For the first 10 or so years of our existence, we were a consumer of batteries. We still are a consumer of batteries, but we were buying them from other people. And I can tell you, I might get the years wrong here, but I think it was 2020 or 2021. I started to get deeply concerned about supply chain, and I was right to be. I mean, the fact is a lot of the battery vendors were concerned that they were not going to be able to produce enough batteries to supply the rapidly increasing demand, waiting for the gigafactories and everything to catch up, right? As usual, it always works. But it's sometimes there's imbalance in the sometime in that process, and particularly with COVID and the other things that we were encountering, that was really worrying. That was my primary objective, but also batteries being the single largest cost contributor to all of our products, more than 30% of the cost of an EV ARC product was just batteries, very like an EV, right? Same ratio with an electric vehicle. With all of those things considered, I acquired the company from whom I'd been buying the batteries for the last 10 years. And I did it to defend our supply chain. I did it to recapture the margin because, of course, as I say, with being the single largest cost contributor to our product, there was a lot of margin that we were losing on there. And I also did it because, like many other components that we, our product is a combination of our own in-house manufactured components that no one else makes, and then others off-the-shelf stuff. We tend to buy the most expensive, highest quality stuff that we can get, because as I said, we need that highest energy density possible in a small space, and you get what you pay for. But I can tell you this, that the stuff that we buy from others is never exactly right for our products. So we pay for things, and then our engineers get on them, and we spend a lot more time and energy making them right for what we're trying to do. And that was the case with the batteries as well. So the other purpose behind buying the battery company was that we could move towards a more bespoke solution for for our products. We're about to release a new product in the next few months called EV Standard, which is a streetlight replacement product with a light wind turbine tracking solar array. And then the pole, nice round pole full of batteries. Everybody makes square and rectangular batteries. That wouldn't work very well in our streetlight product. Well, we can make round batteries because we can make our own bespoke battery solutions here. So buying the battery company was fantastic. It's been very good for us economically. It's been very good from business continuation point of view. But beyond that, we get a lot of other customers with it too. We're putting batteries in drones, robots, medical devices. I'm not only a believer that the world is moving to electrification for transportation, but and everything else, frankly. But I'm also a believer that we're not just moving to an electrified world, but we're moving to an untethered electrified world. Just think in your own life. Things that used to run on two-stroke gasoline motors, for example, and then you started plugging them into an extension cord, well, now they run on batteries, right? That's the evolution. We went from liquid fuels to electricity to untethered electricity. I was in a in a hotel bar in Munich just right after I'd made the acquisition of the battery company. And it was 11 o'clock at night. I had a long day in meetings. I went up to the bartender to order something to eat. And he said, okay, go and sit over at table 11 over there or whatever. And I went and sat down, having ordered from a human being. But my dinner was brought to me by a robot. I'm serious. And when I looked at it, I nearly kissed it. Because I thought, my God, if this isn't a vision of the future, what will all of these things have in common? They will all need bespoke, safe battery packs. What do we make? Bespoke, safe battery packs. So it was a great moment for me, having made this acquisition. There's always a bit of risk in doing that. But I thought, my God. And actually in Heathrow the other day, robotic cleaners now. London Heathrow, moving around cleaning the floors. So the battery acquisition has been fantastic. Very talented people. Saeed Al-Halaj, our chief battery scientist, he was the founder of Allcell. He's just been over to Serbia with me, where we've been presenting utility-scale battery storage to leaders from four or five nations over there, and lots of other great things happening in that business. Very good. I love batteries. And of course, because I'm a new American, I want to see more and more of this place taking place within our shores. And so we make our own batteries in Chicago, and we're proud of that. And we're going to continue to do that into the future. Yeah, the ARC Mobility Trailer, just very quickly. ARC Mobility Trailer is interesting only in that it's a specialized piece of equipment to move EV ARCs around. That's just beautiful functionality where a single operator can deliver an EV ARC to a location and deploy it in less than an hour and drive away and it's ready to charge a car. And that's because we have the specialized piece of equipment. Now, we initially built them for our own use, to cut out more people in the equation, be more vertically integrated, including transportation. But we soon discovered that our customers all wanted them too. And so we're now producing the trailers at a tremendous lick. Anybody that buys a few EV ARC wants a trailer so that they can move them around if they need to. If their charging requirements change or their lease runs out or something else, they want to resurface their parking lot. Just move the EV ARCs around to do that with your trailer.
Very nice. So back to Allcell a little bit. I've been following that technology for years. Their underlying battery cooling technology is what I thought I'd try to provoke a few comments about next here. It's a phase change composite, just for our listeners of standpoint there. This is like the phase change material we're all familiar with. Water has two phase changes. It goes from a gas to a liquid to a solid at designer temperatures, if you will. And this phase change composite can do the same thing. So superior cooling, probably a few other attributes you can mention. How's that working for you? Is that giving you an advantage in the marketplace, having such superior cooling?
Yes, by the way, Tom, I love some of the things you're bringing up here. I love the fact that you brought up water as a phase change material. Of course, one of the unique aspects of water is that it's lighter as a solid than it is as a liquid. And were it not, there'd be no life on the planet, because ice would sink to the bottom and kill everything. It's just one of the fascinating and fantastic things about it. Look, back to the phase change material. It was crucial to us. As I mentioned earlier, what was essential to the making the EV ARC and becoming EV standard work was our ability to have a passive thermal management solution. And that's essentially what the PCC gives us. It's a very simple thing when you hold it in your hand, But you can imagine there's been many, many years. It was a spin out from a university. The material science that went into it's very, very considered. And even if you have the ingredients, the way those ingredients are mixed together and the timing of it and the way that just the whole process is absolutely crucial to its efficacy. And what it allows us to do is it allows us to keep those battery cells in that Goldilocks zone that I was talking about. It's a fantastic insulator, but most importantly, it moves heat around in a way which is very helpful to us. Really incredible material, by the way. If you hold it in your hand, it has the mass and the sort of tactile qualities of plastic, but it has the thermal qualities of a piece of aluminium that you've just pulled out of the fridge. So you've got this really lightweight, plasticky feeling thing in your hand, which is sucking heat out of your hand as though you were holding onto a fantastic conductor like aluminium or something. That was one of the things that first struck me about it. I was just sort of amazed when I first picked it up. What we're able to do is, first of all, and crucially, we're able to prevent thermal runaway from taking place, where you've got a bunch of battery cells next to each other. No one yet has figured out how to stop every battery cell that's produced from running away at some point. You know, and it's 1 in 100 million or 1 in 300 million. It doesn't matter. There's an awful lot of cells out there. You're going to have them running away from time to time. And then there are other things, externalities, penetrations or impacts or whatever else like that can make cells run away. What we want to make sure of is not that one doesn't run away. That's a fool's errand to try and prevent that. But what we want to make sure is that when it runs away, it doesn't make all the others around it run away with that kind of nuclear reaction, right? It's not nuclear, of course, but that kind of exponential propagation. And that's what PCC is so very good at doing, because when that one cell wants to or gets into that kind of temperature where it could cause adjacent cells to run away, the PCC just absorbs rapidly that thermal energy and draws it away from the cell and most importantly defends the cells around it from getting there. But there are lots of other really interesting things we can do as a result of our ability to keep the batteries in those Goldilocks zones. We're able to charge them faster without hurting them because we can reduce the thermal impact when we charge them faster. We can put more energy into them for the same reason and increase their lives, the length of their lives. And all of those things result in a lower cost for stored energy because you're making the cells more energy dense, you're able to charge them quicker so your downtime is lower, and they live longer so you don't have to replace them as quickly. So it's a pretty incredible thing. Now, of course, there are other things that go into the BMS and other things that go into making the batteries what it's special, but you're absolutely right to have nailed the crucial differentiator for us is this fantastic patented material that we have.
Yes, I truly appreciate that material, especially that, you know, different formulations can give you different transition temperatures. If you need it to be one temperature for one chemistry or one ambient environment, you can make that formula. If needed, you can change that designer transition temperature. We can't do that with water, unfortunately, unless we add stuff to it. So that being the case, on to some different topics here. You know, we arguably got ahead of our skis a little bit with the EV rollout across America. You know, the demand sort of hit a brick wall here. It hit not just what appears to be a brick wall, but you know, it has a lot of elements. It's got a political element. It's got an out-of-materials element in that, you know, batteries are increasingly difficult to make cost-effectively with the difficult materials that go into them. That's all changing. But how about the demand for you? I can imagine that there's a great deal of demand for a product like what you're offering here. How's that working? Have you seen any hiccups in your own demand as a function of the hiccup in EV demand in America?
Okay, so there's several very interesting points there. And I want to make sure that we sort of touch on all of them a little bit. But let's start with the last thing that you brought up, which is demand for us versus, you know, EV. Any new technology that comes out, you're going to see fluctuation in demand, right? It's you've got your early adopter, then you start to get a bit more mainstream, and then, you know, other things impact the cost. I mean, where EVs are concerned, interest rates impact the adoption rates. But I do want to come back to EV adoption rates in a minute, because the truth is quite different than the story. So where we're concerned, what I will say is this is a good news, bad news thing. The simple fact of the matter is I believe that infrastructure will be behind EV adoption for the next two decades. And the simple reason for that is because it's easier to put people's bottoms into EVs than it is to put charging infrastructure into the places where they want to charge their cars. And so we're going to be playing catch up for a long time. Now, what playing catch up does is it means that it tends to smooth out the fluctuations in the EV adoption rates, because we're still trying to catch up with the really heavy demand that we saw three or four quarters ago now. And by the time we get through a period of softening, the demand picks up again, we're still trying to catch up, right? So that tends to flatten out that line. This is not perfection. There's no such thing as perfection, but it certainly, I think you'll see where the adoption rates in EVs will be very dramatic, ups and downs. I think you'll see infrastructure be a much flatter line, and always with growth for the next several decades, actually, but particularly the next two decades. Coming back to EV adoption rates, let's just again use some facts and numbers. I have an 18-year-old and a 16-year-old, and one of the things I discipline them to all the time is to separate opinion from fact. And I wish everybody would do that, particularly the media and the political class, right? Because in fact, what we hear is a great deal of opinion and a lot of waffling that the facts don't line up to. So EVs, last year, better than 50% growth year over year for electric vehicles. This year, forecast to be better than 30%, but in the first 2 months of the year, about 70% year over year growth. Ford, who often cited as one of the car companies who's having to completely backtrack from EVs and the whole plan's unraveling and all that sort of stuff, 80% year-over-year growth in the first quarter of this year. I just read the Wall Street Journal this morning. There was an article in the Wall Street Journal this morning about GM, who's making lots of money selling their SUVs and pickup trucks. And in the article, the Wall Street Journal said, and this is partly because EVs are unraveling, but then went on to say that General Motors will produce 10 times more electric vehicles this year than they did last year in the same article. It's just flabbergasting. The separation between truth and story is flabbergasting. So I think the first thing that we all need to do is just take a breath and say, hang on a minute. Is that your opinion, or is that something you heard on some channel or something like that? Or do you have some factual numbers to back up what you're saying? I try to limit myself to the facts. Whatever else happens, there are a couple of other really important things to consider here. First of all, the European Union has announced the outright ban of the sale, but all of but zero emission vehicles in 2035. Now, Europe is the largest automotive market in the world. 405 million cars in Europe versus 319 million in China, 290 million in the United States. US auto manufacturers cannot make internal combustion engine vehicles for North America and EVs for Europe in the current supply chain world that we live in. Four or five decades ago, yes, you could have done that profitably. But today, impossible. That means that US auto manufacturers will electrify because the markets are bigger overseas than they are here. So we're going to electrify. The Biden politics, it's all, none of it matters. At the end of the day, this will be a consumer-led revolution. And that's the most powerful force known to man, frankly, particularly the US consumer will end up leading this revolution. And the good news is that they won't do it because they're forced to by government. They won't do it because the Europeans have passed a law or anything else like that. They'll do it because the experience is better. The single biggest impediment for electric vehicles today is that people don't know how cool they are to own. And then the one right after that, of course, is lack of charging infrastructure. We're in the business of solving that. And we will. Infrastructure is always built. You know, when cell phones first came out, there were nowhere near enough cell towers. Everybody complained about lack of coverage, and the cell carrier said it was too expensive and all that sort of stuff. Look where we are today, right? It will get built because the consumers will demand it. So I think we've got to really debunk this idea that EVs are in decline. I'd love to have this kind of failure, right? You know, where you've got double-digit growth every year and increasing demand globally and all that sort of stuff.
Sign
and
me
all
up.
Yeah. Yeah, I know, exactly. What a wonderful failure to have, right? So, yeah, I think that's something that we really have to debunk, and then just understand that infrastructure will be playing catch-up for a long time to understand where our business is in that mix.
So, you know,
one other thing you brought up, sorry, just
okay.
You brought up minerals, and you're right to. I think this is one of the things that's absolutely shocking today, that because I am, as I said, I love the United States. I love the West. I like our values. I like the way we do things. I mean, by the way, I'm fully aware that we make lots of mistakes and we screw things up. But I think we do things better than the others, than the options. Let me put it that way. We have all the lithium, all the cobalt, all the nickel, all that, everything that we need to make batteries, either in the United States, with vast lithium deposits in the United States. We have everything that we need to make in the United States or within the friendly Western democracies. We could easily have a 100% Western democracy battery supply chain. But for one thing, will, political will, right? And so there's no reason that we need to be going overseas and giving ourselves another risky supply chain like we've had with oil. Let's not fool ourselves. We spend $50 billion a year defending the Straits of Hormuz to keep low and stable oil prices. That's a risky supply chain. Look at what's going on in the Middle East right now. Look at what's happening to oil prices. It's a risky supply chain. Let's not repeat that. We could easily solve all of this, but it will take a little bit of political will, and we need to focus on doing the right things for both extraction and refining. And then in the future, recycling will solve everything for us, because even with today's technology, you can recycle 98% of a lithium-ion battery. Today's technology. That will mature, will get better, and in the future, the extractive and refining industries will be reduced very dramatically. The recycling industries will be increased very dramatically. And that's the great benefit of all of us.
Yeah, that's something really important to me personally here, is that while people are making analogies to other things you might dig out of the ground, such as, you know, oil for fuel, this mineral access is something somewhat temporary or provisional, because eventually we'll get the materials out of the ground that we need, and then recycling will be the vast majority of those sources going forward. So I totally appreciate that. We don't have to dig forever. So we spoke, you touched on a subject that I found interesting, and that is, you know, what's cool about EVs? You know, one of the things that always keeps popping up for me, and I'll segue back to you with this story, but one of the more popular memes out there today when you see them is the EV charger with the diesel-powered generator behind it, and, you know, people making a mockery of that. And, you know, I had one come across my news feed, and I had to comment just a couple of days ago and said, yeah, that's indeed, you know, one of the cool things about EVs is you can charge it from nearly anything that makes electricity. And, you know, you have a choice as an EV owner. I don't have that with my gasoline car. So, you know, when you talk about the different sources you can power a car from, wind, solar, those are no-brainers. We want it to be green. But there's also natural gas, nuclear, coal, diesel, as I mentioned. So many choices. But as an EV owner, you get to pick and choose where you plug in, and the integrity of that source may or may not be important to you personally. So it kind of falls into this category of, okay, I have an EV, and yeah, when I plug it in there, I'm powering it from coal. Shame on me, I shouldn't do that. But if I drive across town and plug in over there, I'm powering from natural gas, so that's not so bad. So it's not the car's fault, it's not the technology's fault, it's the user's fault for the way they apply it. This is the classic sort of gun shooter argument. You know, when somebody gets killed by a gun, whose fault is it? Is it the gun's fault, or is it the shooter? Or my favorite analogy, the vacuum cleaner. These are great devices until someone picks one up and hits somebody over the head with it. And yeah, it does happen. So why do we outlaw those two? Anyway, jokes aside, what about when there is no choice? You're out in the wilderness, you're in a remote location, or as you mentioned, you're in the middle of a borough in New York, and there's no way to put a substation in for whatever the power requirements might be for charging. So how is that working with regard to being uniquely off-grid as a sort of business plan? You mentioned earlier some of the benefits that you see. You can deploy it places where you couldn't do it otherwise. But how does that scale going forward? Are we going to solve some of these problems that cause it to be the bureaucratic headache that it is to install a station? Or, you know, are we going to just bypass it as you've done? You know, kudos for doing so, but not everybody can do that. And it's not for the meek or the timid either. That's a daunting challenge. So, again, off-grid, what's that meaning for you? And, you know, are there other options besides wind and solar that people might need to do? It kind of falls into the category of sometimes you got to do what you got to do. So quite a mixed bag of topics there, but curious to hear your answers.
Let's start with the first point that you made, that EVs are cool. I drive a pickup truck, which does 0-60 in under 3 seconds.
Nice.
Okay. Right? I was in D.C. the other day. I was meeting with a Republican senator who told me that he didn't think that people liked electric vehicles or would want them in the future. And I said, I don't know about that. I mean, again, I've got a pickup truck that does 0-60 in under 3 seconds. It's just impossible for me to imagine the average consumer going down to the dealership and saying, no, thanks, I don't want that one. I'd rather have the one that takes 10 seconds to get to 60 miles an hour, needs to go to the gas station 3 times a week and needs a bunch of maintenance and all that sort of. And that's the other side. I've been driving electric vehicles of all sorts, by the way, four wheels. The only thing I own that's even faster than that pickup truck is my electric motorcycle, made by an American company. It's even quicker than the bloody pickup truck is, right? So I just can't imagine consumers going down to the dealership and saying, no, thank you, I want the slower one that costs more to maintain and fuel and everything else like that. It won't happen. To come back to your point about infrastructure, this is an enormous task. Goldman Sachs has called it a $6 trillion infrastructure build-out. They're wrong. It'll be more than that. But you know what? We've been through this before. In the early days of gasoline, people used to drive around with jugs on the back of their jalopies and try and find a farm or somewhere where they could beg, borrow, or steal some gas to put into that tank so that when they drove down the road and the car ran out, they could pour it in there. And then, you know, within 20 years, we had sufficient gas stations to allow for, you know, the Model T to be one of the most successful products ever. Right. That this is just the way this works. But you are absolutely right to point out that there is far more versatility in the fueling infrastructure for electric vehicles than there ever has been for any of the liquid fuel vehicles. And actually, to go back to one of the things I said at the beginning of the call, as boring as this charging infrastructure is, it ought to be really exciting. And I want to give you a couple of really important things I like to think about big picture stuff. First of all, if we think about fueling habits for the last 130 plus years, we've had a diversified fuel source. We've had gasoline for cars and motorcycles. We've had diesel for trucks and buses. We've had bunker oil for ships. We've had kerosene for aircraft. They're all coming from the same thing, but they're really diverse. You cannot put an aircraft kerosene in a motorcycle's tank. You cannot put gasoline in a diesel bus's tank, right? They're highly diverse. But the transaction has been identical for the last 130 plus years. You go somewhere, you put units of energy into a box, you part with cash at the point of that. Now, what I'm just going to say to you is that fueling in the future is going to go completely the opposite way. We're going to have no diversity of fuel. It's all going to be electrons. And it doesn't matter what vehicle you're putting it into, it will all be electrons. But the charging transaction is going to be as fantastic and as innovative as the great minds in the world can think of, right? So gone are the days where with certainty it's just unit of energy, unit of cash. Now it's going to be, are you an Amazon Prime member? Do you lease a Ford F-150 Lightning and therefore you can drive on sunshine for the lifetime of the lease as long as you use this network? As fantastic and as innovative as the business models that great people, particularly Americans, can dream up, that's what you're going to see in terms of the fueling transaction of the future. And that's really exciting, actually. It's almost like a game now. Instead of just parting with your hard-earned cash, and if you think about it, paying for gasoline is as close to a tax as anything you'll ever do. You cannot not do it. You have no choice. No one can survive without driving around, not in any meaningful way here. So it's basically not even discretionary spend. You have to do it. In the future with electrification, that's going to change dramatically. So that's fantastic. The other thing I think is absolutely fantastic and really worth pointing out in the remaining moments that we have, I really want your listeners to think about this. The United States was the undisputed leader in the automotive world right up until about the 60s, made the best cars in the world and made the most of them and just did a fantastic job of it. And then we handed that baton to Europe and Asia, and we've been playing follow the leader ever since. It's in many ways shocking and embarrassing. Until now, the best and most fantastic electric cars and best and most fantastic cars in the world are made by American companies. Your Teslas, your Rivians, we hear a lot of news about Chinese coming and all that sort of stuff, but the simple fact of the matter is the very best cars are made by American companies. And the reason that those two things are related is because America has two really good things going for it. First of all, we have an innovation society, an innovation culture, that where that's prized above all other things. Other cultures have obedience. Other cultures have kleptocracy or whatever else. We have innovation as being the number one thing that we have. And then we also have fantastically efficient capital markets. And when you combine innovation and fantastically efficient capital markets with the electrification of transportation, you get what we have right now, which is just this opportunity for tremendous new models and the best vehicles in the world. And the US taking back its position as being number one in the automotive and fueling world. And I am all for that.
Very good. You know, I think in the hour we've spent here, you've gone a long ways towards dispelling the myth that electrification will cure your insomnia, especially infrastructure. So it is exciting. It should be more exciting to people. They should understand just the wild proliferation of technologies that are happening as we speak. This is not vanilla cookie cutter stuff. It is about innovation and, you know, getting ahead of your competition leaps and bounds and, you know, providing new and different ways to charge vehicles. So appreciate all that you've done there at Beam Global to try to address that issue. And it seems to be working well. So, with that, I think we should close out. If you have any closing comments, Desmond, certainly now's your chance here.
No, it's been a great opportunity. I love the direction the conversation has taken, and I think this is all about innovation. And it's a fantastic future. I've been doing it for 10 years. I absolutely love it. There's no way I would go back. I don't think anybody would once they've experienced it, particularly not the way I have. And it's going to take everything. It's going to take the grid. It's going to take off-grid solutions. It's going to take storage. It's going to take renewables. But I do think that the future, one of the things that's most exciting about this, just in the same way that we're going to use recycling to solve the extraction problem, the digging up of the ground and all that sort of stuff, I do think that where we're heading in the end, any way you look at it, is we're going to be looking at renewable energy and we're going to be looking at electrification of transportation. And that is fantastic because, first of all, it's going to save everybody a lot of money. The unit cost for energy is absolutely nothing after you've amortized for the cost of construction. There is no unit cost of the energy. And secondly, if you care about it, and not everybody does, and you don't have to, but if you do care about the environment, the simple fact of the matter is that transportation and the generation of electricity contribute about 60 to 70% of US and global harmful emissions. Driving on sunshine, which is what our products enable, remove both sources. There simply isn't anything that we could be doing which is more impactful economically, geopolitically, we're not relying on others for fuel when we do this, and environmentally, if you care about it. And again, you don't have to, but it's, I've got kids.
All right. Well, thank you, sir. Desmond Wheatley, CEO of Beam Global. It's an honor having you on the show today, and look forward to a discussion in the future as we follow up and see how things have changed since today. So,
my great pleasure. Thanks, Tom. Great questions.
Cheers.